This week on Jerusalem Dateline, the ungodly brutality of ISIS. Did the radical Islamic army finally go too far, even for most Muslims? Plus, international interference. How some believe the Obama administration is working to defeat Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in the upcoming elections. And American Christians gather to show their support for the Jewish state. Our report from the Israel summit. Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell, coming to you this week from just outside the walls of the Old City. The world expressed shock and rage at a video reportedly showing ISIS burning alive a Jordanian pilot. Jordan retaliated by executing a number of terrorists in their custody. And Jordan's King Abdullah vowed to fight this Islamist army until his country ran out of fuel and bullets. Gary Lane has more.
An ambulance transports the bodies of two Al-Qaeda terrorists executed at this prison. The Jordanian government made good on its pledge to kill the terrorist captives if the Islamic State harmed Air Force pilot Maoz al-Qasasbe. It took the action after a gruesome video appeared on the internet this week, showing the caged Jordanian pilot being burned to death by ISIS militants. The video is too graphic for us to show you, but it sparked outrage and protests throughout the Jordanian kingdom. And this response from President Obama as he met with Jordanian King Abdullah at the White House Tuesday.
It's just one more indication of the viciousness and barbarity of this organization.
ISIS militants captured Qasasbe after his plane went down during an airstrike in Syria last December. The Jordanians had hoped to exchange the pilot in a swap offered by ISIS. The Islamic State wanted to win the release of this female terrorist. But before the exchange could be arranged, the Jordanians demanded one big condition.
We want to see a proof of life.
But when that gruesome video of the pilot's death by incineration appeared on the internet, the Jordanians knew it was too late for a hostage swap. As a matter of fact, the pilot's death may have actually occurred a month ago, long before exchange talks began. The Jordanian pilot execution video came just days after ISIS released a video showing the beheading of a Japanese Christian journalist.
At some point, this kind of act backfires on a group like ISIS.
The Jordanian government had promised to retaliate by delivering a strong, earth-shaking, and decisive response to their pilot's murder. What isn't known at this time is if the execution of the two Al-Qaeda terrorists is it, or a much greater response is yet to come. Gary Lane, CBN News.
Speaking on the 700 Club, CBN News terrorism analyst Eric Steckelbeck told Pat Robertson that while some will abhor this act, others will be drawn to ISIS because of it.
On one hand, this absolutely energizes ISIS's enemies. Look at Jordanians in the streets protesting against ISIS. But on the other hand, and this is tough to wrap our heads around, Pat, there are people around the world who see ISIS beheading people and setting people on fire, raping women and children. And, Pat, they're not repelled by it. They're actually drawn to it. I know it sounds crazy to people, but we have thousands and thousands of recruits from right here in the West who continue, after all the beheading videos, after the burning video yesterday, they will continue to flock to the Islamic State. They are drawn to this kind of sadistic violence, especially here in the West. Pat, look, we've been raised on a culture here over the past several decades of violent movies, video games, torture, bloodshed in everything we watch. It's almost people have become desensitized to it, and they see what ISIS is doing. They think it's a cool thing, all this blood, gore, violence, and conquest. But the main thing is ISIS is winning. They are expanding their territory, and success plus this gore and this sadistic violence breeds attraction to many, many radical Muslims around the world.
To watch the full interview with Eric Steckelbeck on the 700 Club, you can go to our website at cbnnews.com. Well, here in Israel, the country is in the middle of national elections, and some are accusing a group called V15 of using American money and personnel to undermine the campaign of Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. Here's the report I filed on this controversy. This is the opening of another Victory 2015, or V15 Center, one of around 10 throughout Israel. It's a growing movement thanks to outside money and American political know-how. The goal? Influence Israel's upcoming election. V15 has opened up volunteer centers throughout the country. This is the latest opening, located in the heart of Jerusalem. Their mission? To unseat Netanyahu.
Our whole purpose is to go door by door and to call supporters and to call voters and to pledge people not to vote for Netanyahu in the coming elections.
Itamar Wiseman helped start V15 and picked up a willing supporter in One Voice, a U.S.-based organization.
We were approached by One Voice to give us a donation. We were so thrilled that successful businessmen want to invest in Israel's future.
One Voice also provided the services of Jeremy Bird, a field director in both of President Obama's winning White House runs.
I specifically met with Jeremy. He helped us try to think outside the box and how we could organize people here.
Wiseman credits Bird with bringing along his successful U.S. campaign strategies to Israel.
He gave us intellectual resources on how to organize people, like what should be the structure of volunteers, like a concept of having a regional field director, and we want to actually bring amazing concepts in the U.S. that are worked for a lot of parties. He's doing wonderful work with us.
I see this as a very serious negative matter. An organization, a nonprofit, was especially established with foreign money, especially American money, to intervene in the elections.
Professor Eitan Gilboa is the director of the Center for International Communication at Bar-Ilan University.
B15 argues that they are not affiliated in any way with a particular party and that they only represent an idea. Well, what is the idea? The idea is to remove the Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu from power.
Current Israeli law prohibits large contributions to political parties from foreign sources.
Now, this is like a trick, a maneuver to circumvent Israeli elections law, which I consider to be misleading the Israeli electorate.
U.S. Senator Ted Cruz and Representative Lee Zeldin are complaining about One Voice's involvement to the State Department because it has partnered with and given grants to the organization. Their letter reads, "There appears to be a danger that U.S. taxpayer funds are being used to directly shape the outcome of the upcoming Israeli election, and specifically the campaign against Prime Minister Netanyahu." The State Department denied any taxpayer money given to One Voice went to V15. Israel's Likud party has also filed a complaint against V15 to the Israeli Supreme Court. V15 argues the Likud also uses foreign money and consultants for their campaigns. Gilboa says there's a difference.
Those non-profits operating on the right, they get only private money and they operate around the year. V15, affiliated with the left, supporting the left, has been established just and primarily for the elections, and we don't know much about their sources of funding. It's not the same thing.
Current polls show a close race, and Israelis hope the outcome won't be engineered by foreign influence, especially from its closest ally.
Well, joining me to talk more about the election campaign in Israel is CBN correspondent Julie Stahl. Julie, you know, in addition to the V15 controversy, what is some of the dynamics going on in the campaign right now?
Well, the main left-right divide is the left wing says, no, we're going to promote socioeconomic policies that Israelis are, they're upset about the economy, some of the social issues, and as opposed to on the right, Bibi, you know, and rightly so, is concerned about defense and security issues. So that's kind of the divide between right and left. Of course, both sides care about both things, but Bibi is really strong on the security and defense issues.
And the campaign is about 6 weeks away. How would you describe how things are going for the main parties?
Well, Likud seems to be gaining some ground in the last polls that we saw this week, and Benjamin Netanyahu would be moving up in the polls. The left is kind of stagnated a bit right now. It's one of the analysts that I spoke to in the last few days said, you know, the left may have kind of underestimated the whole idea of Bibi fatigue, mm-hmm. that Benjamin Netanyahu has been prime minister on and off for more or less 9 years. And they think, you know, people think, well, we want to change, but there's nobody else really really there. And the left thought they could just attack Bibi and that would be enough for a campaign. But apparently, you know, it's kind of like when your family is attacked, doesn't matter, you might right. complain right. about them from within, but if your family's attacked from the outside, you're going to stand up and defend them.
And one thing that's getting a little attention is a new ad that Bibi has put out called Bibi Sitter, as opposed to a babysitter. How are people reacting to that?
I think it was a brilliant idea. I mean, Bibi's trying to make himself the family man, and I think people think it's humorous. I don't think, no matter which side you're on, you couldn't say it wasn't clever. So I think it's quite a clever idea.
Yeah, it is. And finally, Julie, one of the controversies, both here in Israel and in the United States, is this invitation by the House Speaker John Boehner to Netanyahu to come and speak about Iran just a few weeks before the election. And it's got a lot of attention, a lot of pushback from the White House and Democrats. How do you think that's going to affect the outcome of the election?
I think here in the land, it may not actually have a very big impact. There again, you know, the right is, I think, getting a bit tired of people attacking Bibi, whereas the left isn't really, it's not working now. Now people are starting to say, hey, show us what are you going to do for us if we take Bibi out and put you in? Right. So I'm not sure it's going to have a big impact on the elections here.
Yeah. Okay, Julie. Well, thanks for your analysis. We'll see what happens just a few weeks away. It's going to be a major thing here in Israel.
Yeah.
Coming up, we go to the U.S. for a first ever summit on how Christian ministries can stand up for Israel. Welcome back. A new organization called FIRM, the Fellowship of Israeli-Related Ministries, held its inaugural meeting in Colorado. CBN News senior editor John Waggy attended that meeting and brings us this report from the Israel Summit.
We're near the foothills of the Rocky Mountains, where a group of Christian and Messianic believers have gathered to voice their Bible-based support for Israel and the Jewish people at a critical time in history.
As conditions get worse globally for Jews and Christians, the message from the Israel Summit is clear. It's time for those who believe the Bible to stand with Israel.
Here at Resurrection Fellowship, hundreds of Christian and Jewish believers are on hand to witness the launch of a global effort called FIRM, the Fellowship of Israel-Related Ministries.
Jerusalem pastor Wayne Hilsden founded FIRM to be a bulwark against hatred and to bless the world by supporting Israel and the Jewish people. He says it will come with a cost.
Certainly among many in the Islamic world, we the Sunday people are viewed as just as bad as the Saturday people. And there may come a day soon when our lives will be at risk because of our commitment to love and bless the Jewish people.
Rabbi Jonathan Bernus says the hatred of Jews is an outgrowth of a fierce spiritual clash between God and Satan.
Folks, we are in a battle. We are facing a very real enemy who is wounded and truly believes that he can stop God's plan from being fulfilled. What's our job? Fulfill the plan.
Anti-Semitism is at its strongest on many college campuses, so the summit is paying special attention to young people. 22-year-old Michael Mistretta has a key role in reaching them with a message that's more spiritual than political.
As a young person, when I think about God, how he forgives me, how he shows me mercy, how much more will he do the same to Israel? How much more will his love endure forever?
The Stand With Israel movement is worldwide, and the people who came to Colorado are from at least a dozen countries and many U.S. states.
Gathering together with others that have the same heart and same mind to see God's purposes fulfilled, to see Israel supported, to see the Jewish people come back to their own Messiah.
Beth Shear says the summit changed her perspective.
Knowing that times are going to be coming where they're not even really going to like us for what we stand for, but that we still need to stand for them and know that our God is for them.
Rabbi Bernus believes that the uniting of Jewish and Gentile leadership can solve many serious problems.
Like the rise of anti-Semitism, the growth of replacement theology, anti-Israel attitudes. We need to deal with this together. And we need to do it now.
According to a Google search, the distance between Loveland and Jerusalem is more than 6,800 miles. But in the hearts and minds of these people at the summit, the distance is a lot shorter than that. Reporting from Loveland, Colorado for Jerusalem Dateline, I'm John Waggy.
Up next, the power of a healing prayer in the midst of the crisis in northern Iraq. Welcome back. When ISIS went through northern Iraq last summer, it left more than 1 million refugees in its wake. We talked with Abby Abeldness of Healing Tree International about how practical help and healing prayer
are making a difference in their lives.
Well, Abby, it's great to have you here, and good to see you again. And you were just in December in Kurdistan. Tell us what the conditions were like.
Okay, well, we were there in the Kanki camp of the where the Yazidis mm-hmm. are, and it was getting colder,
yeah.
and it was more rainy in the area, and the people were just trying to keep warm. They were actually needing people to send them mm-hmm. warmer clothes. But things have become a lot more organized in the camps now, and the families actually are adopting children that may have lost their parents or mm-hmm. their siblings. They're just adopting them into homes in the camps.
You mean so like one family will realize that these children are orphans and they'll adopt them?
Right, because uh-huh. they haven't found all their family members yet. They don't know what happened to them.
We were there in August. It was very hot at the time, mm-hmm. and literally hundreds and thousands of Yazidis were coming off the mountain into these refugee camps. You probably saw it maybe a few months after we did. Mm-hmm. The trauma is hard to underestimate. Right. It was just horrific, I mean, what they had gone through. Emotionally and psychologically, what are they going through?
I was there in September, and thinking about the horrible, the horrific things that happened to them, and wanting to help that with some healing prayer, and we would ask them questions about what is the trauma that you want help with, and I was surprised at the answer, that the biggest concern was, where was God when all this happened? Why didn't he stop this harm from coming to us? And so they had that on top of everything is the big questions about what is God doing?
And what was happening when you prayed for people?
Well, that was the beginning of the open door. You know, it's the first time that they ever talked to Christians. When they were up on Sinjar Mountain, they had never allowed any Christians up there. So in a sense, they were an unreached people group. Mm-hmm. And so it just was orchestrated by God that the Christians were the first ones to visit them while they're sitting there in the same clothes they had on when they had first come off the mountain. And they said, where's God? And we said, well, we're here from the United States to come over. God heard your cry. Mm-hmm. And we've come to help you. And because of that, we'd like to pray for you since that's your concern. And they were so open to that prayer. And the stunning thing to us was how healing it turned out to be. They let us lay our hands on their heads or touch their shoulders, and we would pray, and we could see the stress come off of them to think, God is watching over us. He sent somebody to help, and it was like they felt the power of God because you saw a dramatic difference in the children getting off their mats and getting up to play after being prayed over, and you saw a mood change as the prayer happened in the camps. So it was extremely effective. Mm. And then they would start bringing us, as they saw the help that it was being to their people, they just started crowding around us and bringing us more traumatized people and saying, would you pray over and minister to those people? So it was very impacting, and they would say things like, we see what Islam, we see that it came and it kills and destroys, and then we see what Christianity does, and it comes to help, and it has compassion, and it cares for you and wants to help to rebuild. So they were very impacted by what the Christians were doing there.
Up next, young tennis players from South Africa see Israel firsthand and find out it's not apartheid after all. Finally this week, many world leaders and the media often accuse Israel of being an apartheid state because of its policies towards Palestinians. Now the Jewish state is reaching out to South Africans who lived under that racial segregation for almost 50 years. Julie Stahl has that story.
When South African tennis coach Moses Ntuping brought four of his young tennis players to Israel, it was something he had waited for all his life.
This is a dream come true for me.
As a teenager, Ntuping developed into a star tennis player, but could never travel or play on national teams.
Unfortunately, during those apartheid years, we have not been given opportunity to experience what I'm experiencing now at this age, at my age.
Ronen Morali of the Israel Tennis Center invited the group to visit. He said the idea came from the Israeli ambassador who wanted to introduce the South Africans to the real Israel.
Sport, you know, it's like a bridge over, you know, over cultures, over, you know, to bring, you know, people together and to see that Israelis are, you know, are normal people, you know, without horns in their head, and I think it did the job.
Netuping said he saw nothing that resembled the racial segregation of apartheid.
So far, I haven't seen anything that I can criticize about Israel. All I could see is people, jolly people, friendly people, all the way, willing to help wherever possible.
And it touched the youngsters as well.
I knew about Israel fighting, there's a war, but I thought where I'm going, there would be a peace place and no war there.
They're so kind to us. I see they're treating us like families.
I think it's an incredible country that has incredible people, kind people, that must appreciate people from Africa or Northern America or South America, the whole world.
The Israel Tennis Center started nearly 40 years ago. Now they have 14 centers around the country, like this one in Jerusalem, serving 20,000 children a week from different backgrounds.
The Israel Tennis Center is a blend of everything, you know, like you have Arab kids, you have Ethiopian kids, you have everything, you know, a blend of everything. You know, you have Christians, you know, you have Arab Christians, you have, like, it's like a blend of everything. This is what, you know, why this project is so beautiful.
Like Mohammed, who is Muslim, and his Jewish friend, Omer. Both want to eventually turn professional and say their friendship is the best part of the tennis center. That positive atmosphere helps when new players visit.
The first time I play with the kids from South Africa, and I like to play with them.
I didn't realize that I will play with them. It's just so unreal, I think.
This first exchange proved successful, and those at the Israel Tennis Center hope for many more opportunities in the future. Julie Stahl, CBN News, the Israel Tennis Center, Jerusalem.
Well, the kids had a lot of fun, and they found out that Israel was a lot more peaceful than they expected. Well, that's it for this edition. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time on Jerusalem Dateline.